I couldn't be in the direction of the Velvet Underground because only the Velvet Underground could make that sound, and I didn't have a band, so I was going to be stuck with studio musicians.
David phoned up and said, have you ever heard of a band called Velvet Underground? I said, I think so. And he said, well, there's the one of the guys, Lou Reed, wants to do an album, and it's at Trident Studios. Do you want to do it? It's 3 days' work.
You know, it was really good fun. I really enjoyed myself in the studio. Lou Reed sat in the corner somewhere. I can't remember ever seeing him, actually. I don't remember seeing him there at all. But he was there somewhere in a gloomy corner with dark glasses on and dressed in black.
I just, you know, ran over the songs with them. By that, I mean the chord structure and the melody. Vicious. You hit me with a flower. Every hour, you're so vicious, vicious. You want me to hit you with a stick? All I got's a guitar pick. You're so vicious.
Vicious is a song that, you know, has its origins in Reed's relation with Andy Warhol.
You know, he said, why don't you write a song called Vicious? I said, Vicious? What kind of vicious? He said, Vicious, I hit you with a flower. I said, oh, what a great idea.
The whole setup for this was to try and make it a lot more basic than a lot of the Bowie things that we'd done in the past. And we just started off with bass drums, two guitars, and some of the tracks had more overdubs than others. This particular one, Vicious, it was kept sparse.
Vicious! Baby, you're so vicious.
And there was an effect that we tried that I don't think was used vicious in the mix at all. But it's still on the multi-track.
Vicious.
It's a backwards echo on the...
Vicious.
It's this effect.
Vicious. Vicious.
All together, it becomes...
You know, Lou was so laid back, and I kind of walk into the studio, go, hey, you know, like, sort of sit down in the chair, put his guitar on, blam, 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 be all out of tune, and he'd be like, are we ready, you know, like, blam, 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 this guitar's like, way out of tune, not, you know, way out of tune. And I kind of wander off, and I kind of, you know, tune it up a bit, and Lou used to look at me like, you know, hey, okay, you know, he didn't really care whether it was in tune or whether it was out of tune, really. He's kind of wanting to sing the song, you know.
The thing with Ronno is I could very rarely understand a word he said. He had a Hull accent. He'd have to repeat things 5 times. But a really sweet guy. Great guitar player, really sweet guy. Well, the satellite's gone way up to the sky. Things like that drive me out of my mind. Well, I watched it for a little while. I like to watch things on TV. On your satellite of love. Your satellite of love. Your satellite.
I find out what the songs are about when I do them out loud in front of an audience, actually performing them. And over the years, I realized Satellite of Love is really about jealousy. That's what I think it's about. But I could be wrong. I mean, just because I wrote it doesn't mean I know what it's about.
It's a wonderful song, essentially about obsession, about stalking. And, yet it's really a beautiful ballad that also brings out the romance that's sort of at the heart of the obsession. This is somebody who just is following someone everywhere because they don't trust them, but that that lack of trust is based in complete devotion.
Satellite's gone way up to Mars. Soon it'll be filled with parking cars. I watched it for a little while. I love to watch things on TV. Your satellite of love.
It's also got that weird little, humor in it, that whole bridge. You know, I've heard that you've been out with, Harry, Mark, and John, whoever they are, Tom, she's out, whoever this person is, she's out with everybody.
I've been told that you've been bold with Harry, Mark, and John. Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday with Harry, Mark, and John.
When I hear Satellite of Love, I think of all those kids standing on the street corners of Brooklyn when I was a mere tad, hitting notes and harmonizing and trying to sing Stormy Weather. To me, it's the doo-wop Lou, which is a very sweet and tender part of him.
Satellite, that's David. David's amazing at background vocal parts. That bong, bong, bong. That's okay. It's really great. But the really great thing is the high note at the end. I mean, very few people could do that. I just loved when he did that. It's just, what a move. I think everything is really about details. And that was the exclamation mark, I thought. Like when he goes up like that, very few people could do that. Really pure and beautiful.
There he goes. Isn't that great?
That might have been me. Oh, my God.
I think the concept of transformer is very important because, in a sense, that's what the Warhol scene offered to people, these odd misfits, to transform and become their inner beauty, whatever strange and eccentric forms that might take.
What Lou was writing from were experiences that went back to the factory, when he was sitting in the factory and observing this parade of people walking in and, just coming from all kinds of strange corners of culture and society, and watching them interact and mingle and try and make lives for themselves in this freak show.
In the beginning, it was like a bunch of drug-type people, and then when I went to work there, it was my job to kind of get rid of all of those people. And then it was just people that would do one day in a film with them, and they would hang on for, years and years and years.
I was a kid. I was 15 years old. All I wanted to do was learn, and everyone just kept on wanting to have my body. And I went, I don't. All I want to do is learn. I want to grow. But nobody listens to a child.
I used to keep a notebook, but that was just to put down good lines, like people would say really funny things. But I hadn't thought about writing about them. I don't know why I wrote about them.
Holly came from Miami, FLA.